Hello, everyone. Bishop is coming in. You can bring Bishop in.
Oh, you got me. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Okay. Now, this is going to be fun tonight. Let's say a word of prayer. And oh my God.
Hey.
Okay, let me say let's say a word of prayer and then we'll open with the with an appropriate scripture. Sister Shear, why don't you say a word of prayer?
Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, God, for this time and opportunity that you have called us to come together for this night to minister from our families to the families that you have called under the sound of my voice and to the families out into the world. God, I pray that what we say and do tonight, it will bring enlightenment. It will bring impact. It will impact others. It will empower with the word. God, we thank you for how you allowed families to come together. And I pray right now that generational blessings will be upon everyone under the sound of my voice. And God, generational blessings is passed down into our families as well. And we glorify you and magnify you in Jesus' name. Amen.
You're saying they can't hear us? Can they hear us? We're saying no sound.
I don't see that.
Okay. Can y'all hear me? If you can hear me, chat and put something in the chat room. Let me know you can hear.
You have to unmute yourself.
I'm not muted.
I see J. Drew.
Can you all, are they saying yes, they can hear. Okay. And the scripture for today, it's found, everybody knows this scripture. It's found in Joshua. Okay, where am I going? Somebody.
Joshua 5 and 6.
I'm trying to get y'all to come in. Joshua, is anybody? I can't see. What are the chat people saying? I'm trying to see if they're going to get this scripture. Joshua. Okay. They too slow. They not getting it. All right. Joshua 24 and 14. Now, therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That's the word of the Lord that we're going to use on today. And I'm so blessed to have an opportunity to share. I'm so glad for my daughter, Evangelist Kiara Sheard Kelly, my son, J. Drew Sheard II, and then, of course, my lovely wife, Evangelist Dr. Karen Clark Sheard. And what a blessing it is for us to have this opportunity to share with you all on today. And we're going to be talking about some stuff that I hope will be a blessing to you all. It's a little different tonight. We decided to do something different. And there are some things that I know I was supposed to finish up a lesson on tonight, but just wait till Friday, perhaps, and we'll get back to it. Don't hold it against me. But I think that this is good. I was able to get my family together, and we were able to, we're going to share with you on tonight. And hopefully this will be a blessing to you and your family, and we'll go from there. Okay, Kiara?
Can we ask them to like and share, Kiara?
Please, Mother.
Oh, yes. We want everyone to like and share. Of course, this is going to be very, very interesting. It's going to be enlightening. So we want you to share it to your family members. If you have family members, you know, reach out to them and tell them, go on and watch the Sheards tonight. Everybody used to always talk about the Sheard. Everybody remember that? We used to have the Sheard. What was it called?
That's what it was called. The Sheards, the TV show.
The TV show. Everybody remember that? And of course, you're going to get an opportunity, a little taste of it tonight.
Unedited.
Absolutely. Right. Exactly.
Of course, we're all a little bit older. And we don't say things that we said back then, J. Drew, and we're all in a different place.
But you know what? I have to speak up for my son.
You always do.
Here we go. Oh, God.
Okay, come on. Go ahead.
Because everybody remembers that episode when J. Drew, he tried us. And you know what? Ever since then, he has made a difference. I've watched him, and the Lord has truly dealt with him. But the Lord has dealt with him and yet dealing with him. So yes. I just want to encourage families out there. Don't give up on your family members. Actually,
we
are the ones that, you know, that are that steering point that that God uses us to pray for them, cover them, and have patience with them. Because we're not going to all be alike. Yeah. Everybody's not going to think alike in your family. Everybody's not going to agree. But we have to learn to agree to disagree and respect each other's disagreements without falling out and saying, oh, I'm not going to talk to you. So I just want to be a blessing to you tonight.
And if we're shaking, it's because Sister Sheard is talking and hitting the table with her elbows, and it's causing the camera to shake. That ain't me, okay?
Look how mommy looking at you. She looking
at you. And so this is one of the reasons why you have to agree to disagree and not fall out. I'm not going to fall out with my husband because he said I'm shaking. This is the way I do things. This is the way I express myself. So that's an example. And see, you're taking it very well.
You know, before you start, Kiara, and I know this is going, you know, we only have an hour to do this. And so, but here's the thing, you know, this is a matter that is so important when it comes to dealing with family. You raise, in the case of your mom and I, you raise your children to be the best that they can be, and you give them the space to be a personality. You know, you don't, in other words, I didn't try to make J. Drew a clone of me. We didn't try to make you a clone of your mother, but we put in you what we thought was necessary for you to be able to survive, and the development, and we nurtured you, even though at some points we saw stuff that we did not necessarily care for. And what we did is we tried our way to kind of smother that or direct that out of your life. But at the same time, we yet allow you all to grow and mature. And we were busy nurturing your growth so that you could become responsible adults.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I appreciate that. I guess we can just start talking. That's organic. I appreciate that. I appreciate that y'all supported us in making our own decisions and just having us to find what makes sense. Like, we still had this source of accountability, but we also had these parents that weren't trying to live their lives through us or do things that they didn't do through us. It was just, you would share naturally, like, hey, this is what I wish I would have done different. And this is my counsel, but you go ahead and do what you think is best. Of course, you know, until we were older, or what you would consider daddy as grown, which that was when we got our college degrees.
There you go. I wanted to hear you say that.
But I think that that's so important. So I have a question here, which is, why is family important? I guess we can all speak to that. Why do we find that family is important? And is it still a such thing, you know, in today's culture and the church? What do you want to start with that?
Why don't we let J. Drew start? We've all been talking.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. You said why family is important.
Yes. Why is it important to you? Why are we important to you?
Well, I mean, obviously, I love my family and I can't live without my family. Why they're important? I mean, family is just everything. I mean, it teaches you, you know, I mean, it's one of the main values of living. You know, as a young man, as a young black man, you know, it's one of the things that, you know, we you know, having family is how we mold ourselves and become who we are. So without family, I can personally say that I wouldn't be who I am. So that's how important it is. I am who I am because of family, you know. So, yeah, I guess that's my answer.
I guess that's my answer. I agree. I think I love how we support each other when we are dealing with out or external experiences or other situations. I love how we come together and we kind of just talk through them together. And it's like we still tell each other if you're wrong, and we also tell each other, you know what? No, the other side is tripping. And I love that. It gives me a sense of belonging. It gives me a sense of support. And it's proven that the family structure, even if you don't have your biological family there, it's important to have some kind of community. And I think that that's where the whole family piece helps with psychological support as well. So that you're not, you know, you don't have childlike issues. If you know, it's like the little girl in me is doing okay because my dad was there, if that makes sense.
That does make sense, because I hear a lot of, and I'm sure even with, you have your sister program here. Yeah. And I hear a lot of, even in our church, parents, a lot of young people say that they miss that side of their family side of not having that moment with their families, or having that unity, or having that oneness, even though they grew up in the home, but they fell apart as they grew.
Yeah.
And sometimes that can cause some issues too. And that's why I am very adamant about calling you all every now and then. I get on J. Drew. I get on, well, you're very good at it. Kier, she's very good at it. But J. Drew, I have to work on him. I have to reach out to him and say, what are you doing? Are you all right over there? You know, because, you know, it's good to just check on each other. You know, it's so very important, because people fall apart, and that can cause animosity, because they'll have an attitude because, oh, they're not checking on me, so I'm not going to check on them, which is not a good spirit to have. We're family. We're supposed to love each other, you know, overall, you know, to look beyond their faults, you know, and we're family. Let's love each other anyway.
Yeah. I think too, me being a part of this family, I've learned spiritual sonship. So though you all have been there, you know, for us, your natural children, I've learned the value in spiritual sonship. And the blessing that I have noticed is that there are some that we've been connected to that may not have the connection to their biological family, but they've even found that belonging with our family. Even on our holidays, on Thanksgiving or Christmas, we've found ourselves calling family members from church, you know, cousins. And like, I actually have some closer bonds with some fans or friends from the church, if that makes sense, where we really have become like blood. And I think there's a saying where it says blood is not the only thing that makes you related. So I literally have seen with your leadership and your direction, the value in the body of Christ, the family of the church.
Well, you know, and I want to commend you, Kiara, because I recall a young lady that did not have a good relationship with her father. And you made the statement, well, you know, I'll share my dad with you, you know, and that's important because I thank God that we have secured our relationship and that so that our relationship is not threatened by other relationships. Of course, now, you know, we have other people that call your mother and I mom and dad. And it doesn't seem to be a problem with you all because you all know that we're here for you all, you know. And so you, the thing is, we've taught as we've grown to share. And so when we share, there's been such a tremendous amount that we've been able to give to other people and yet at the same time not feel slighted. Within ourselves, within our family. You know, there's this thing that I've heard many preacher's kids say, you know, my dad was there for everybody else, but he didn't see about us, you know. And thank God that we were able to do what we were supposed to do as far as you all were concerned. And at the same time, we were able to help somebody else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure J. Drew can agree. I mean, he was very active in school.
Yeah.
And when he was younger, and J. Drew, you can express, you know, your ways of coming up and how your parents were supportive of you while you were in your playing sports in school. And then sometimes daddy had to come to school and when the teacher called you when you were younger and grab you in front of the students. But I'm going to let
that
you tell
that only happened
the story.
One time. You tell them that only happened one time.
That happened one time.
But you can express the.
But wait, well, no, see, you went there. So now, wait a minute. So I got to jump in. So you got to understand where J. Drew was going. He was going in a just a crazy way. I mean, he's a little crazy little boy. And so I had put him on punishment. I had, you know, taken his favorite toys away. I mean, these are different times. I don't mean I did this all at one time for our audience. We had taken his toys away one time. We had put him on punishment. One time, these are all separate time, I sat down and I cried with him. I mean, me, big old me. I'm sitting up crying with him. I don't know what's going on. Maybe I'm failing you. You know, I'm doing this psychological thing to try to get him back on track. And so I sat up there, cried with him and whatnot. And then after that, I think we put him on another punishment. And then I was like, you know, hey, ain't none of this working. So I went up to his school and caught him in there clowning and smacked him upside the head. We never had that problem anymore. So it's not like, you know, your mom up here trying to act like I just did this. No, this was a whole thing that led up to the last straw that broke the camel's back.
That is funny. No, that is definitely true. I definitely would push the limit. I don't know what I was thinking. As much as fear in my father I had, I was just taking heck of risk. But yes, everything my dad is absolutely true. I was clowning, and now that I understand it, now that I have a son and a daughter, you know, so I totally understand. But no, definitely, my parents have always been supportive, and sometimes, you know, I would even wonder now that I got older and to see things from a different perspective now, I would even wonder how they would be as busy as they were and still be able to make it to our games. That's what I just didn't. And then sometimes, most of the time, most of my games were during Bible study, during Friday night service, and we didn't have too many Sunday games, but they all, my, you know, my dad and my mom always made a way to come out somehow So definitely, even when I was doing other stuff too, that I'm not going to say that they didn't want me to do, but they just wanted me to do things differently. Of course, we can refer to music as it became, you know, when it comes to that. Obviously, my people didn't want me to you know, get too far away off in the industry and all of that stuff. And needless to say, is that they still even supported that. People don't know that my dad pretty much funded half of my career, you know. And I think I would, well, Kiki, we've been in the game for how many years now? What is it, 15?
Yeah.
15 years, and I could say, well, I think Daddy funded all 15 years of our career. Just thought about it. Oh, sorry. Wow. My dad has funded or helped, chipped in, whatever, funded, whatever you want to say, CFO, whatever. He has funded my whole career, and that's been a blessing. So my family is just, you know, I've shared this a few times. I often have people, you know, talk, you know, I have friends that didn't have, you know, a great father such as I, but, you know, they like to have this ego and walk around, you know, saying, well, I ain't had no father, And I can't really agree with that, because I have a father, and I know I wouldn't even be the man I am without my dad. So having that family support is everything. And I can say that my parents definitely were at the game. Kiki came as much of stuff as she could. She probably came to everything. But yes, family support is everything.
Well, you know what we had, and you know what happened in particularly, you know, because J. Drew didn't seem to be that interested in the gospel side. And so we didn't want him to feel that he was not a part, or that we wasn't supporting him. And so you know, even when he came to me with his dream, with his music, you know, and I, you know, we made it. There was never a space that he didn't know that we didn't necessarily approve of what he was doing. But we gave him some guidelines. Okay, we ain't going for that cussing. We ain't going for disrespecting women. That, you mean, you know. He and I had this talk, and if I must say so myself, this is good, because I had a talk with another pastor not too long ago, a bishop in the church, and he was telling me about how his son was going the other way, and his son was rapping and just cussing and going on. And I told him, I said, no, Doc. I said, you make a compromise with him. I know you're going to do that, because there's no need. Let's be real. It's no need of us acting like our kids are going to stop just because we say stop, you know. But it is better if they feel comfortable to share with us, like I did with like J. Drew felt with me. I say, okay, let me hear some of this music. Let me see what you're doing. I say, Knock, we ain't going to be using all that vulgar language. And he agreed. Okay, I won't do that. And we ain't going to be disrespecting women. He agreed. So he had a dream that was not what I wanted it to be, but it was his dream. And so he had to see for himself that that wasn't going to work for him. And I was able to be there to help him, you know, okay, man, go on. But we made a lot. What if you get that relationship right, you'll find out that you can do a lot of compromising and keep them from going way off on the deep end.
I think the compromise too within our family, with you all allowing us to make decisions as adult, the beautiful thing that I've learned and I have seen even with that decision making with both me and J. Drew, because there are some things that you all didn't agree with that I may have done. But somehow, like you said, you found the compromise and you supported us. But it taught me that there are other areas and other spaces. And it's something you said before, Dad, but there are areas and other spaces of where our light should shine. And I think J. Drew made the point before, like, he talked about, like, if I'm not called to be a preacher, maybe my way of preaching is in a different way. Maybe it's me being in a studio, you know, and having these placements that I wouldn't get by just being in the church. And I think that that is just absolutely amazing, because the Bible talks about your light being as bright as a city on the hill. And I think sometimes we're so used to recycling the light rather than having to offer this new way of light and life, which is through Christ Jesus. So I thought that,
recycling the light, yes. Recycling. That's I good. Like it.
Right. Thank you. But yes, I've learned that, and I just
what'd you say, Jay Drew? What'd you say? Yes, sir.
But it's your compromise and your fairness and justice within our home and balance. It's challenged me and pushed me to not be afraid to go in those different spaces, you know, to share the gospel. So I think that my family, and I think even those that we've had the opportunity to just kind of grab a hold on to and say, come in with us, we've all learned under your leadership, even under mommy's leadership, that it's possible to, again, go in these spaces and to not be afraid to go into new territory.
Well, you know, And that's true. I'm sorry, you were going to say something? No, and that's true, because, you know, one of the things that is so important that we taught you all is, and I guess this is more so me than anybody, you know, to have pride in the family. You know, I remember as when Kiara was a little girl, and then they would say, oh, she looks like Dorinda. Oh, and then she grew up. Oh, she looks like Twinkie. Oh. And I would say to Kiara, you are sheared. You are sheared. What's your name? And Kiara was Thai tongue back then. She would say, Kiara sheared. And the thing is if parents don't make or don't think much of yourself or your last name, then you can't expect the kids to, you know, carry this great banner about who you are. And so we did that. You know, I was taught that way. I had great pride in my family as the Shears. Your mom had great pride in her family, the Clarks. And so, you know, it just so happened that, we had to go. We nailed that. You are sheared. Sheards don't act like that. Sheards don't do that kind of stuff, you know. And so that's important. That's important if you're going to be successful in child rearing and building a legacy, you know. So what happened to us is, you know, Kiara did. You did such a great job in your music industry. You know, you have the business acumen, you started your own companies and whatnot. And so when we, you know, we did this, and so we started this, I'm kind of getting ahead of you, Kiara. I was getting ready to talk about how Karoo got started, but go ahead, I'll stop.
I don't want you to stop, Dad, because you're making a great point. And I'm just now realizing, I just want to add to the whole sheer, the family structure. And again, this is not just so that everyone that's watching will understand that we're not just saying it only stops with the biological piece, because we understand that there are some adjustments. I mean, when you talk about Moses, he was sent through the river. He was disconnected from his biological mother. But who is the people that will grab a hold of you and nurture that gift, that assignment that is on your life? It could be the Shears. I'm not saying everybody come on over, but I think there's a such thing, the integrity in the church and not just in your personal home. And I just want to commend you, Daddy and Mommy, for that. But you used to tell us, who are you? I was watching a video and this guy talked about family legacy. He said the Hilton, that's family. He said Rolls Royce, that's family. Those are last names. What else is it? Marriott, those are last names. So it's this sense of ownership and this sense of legacy. And I also think that when you think about those kinds of establishments, they come with a community of people. So I think that just has proved your point for me, because I used to kind of be taught, like, why do Daddy want us to always say what our last name is? But it was the sense of ownership, community, a village. And the village is not just for the child, it's for the adult too. Yeah. So I just wanted to piggyback off of what you said.
You know what? And on that note, you know, I think your dad, I have to give him credit. Whereas, you know, we each played a role. We each played a role as to, it's very important that parents make sure that okay, all growing up, all the children know is what they see in front of them. And it's so important that we play the role of living the life exemplary so that they could see, okay, this is how you react. And Dad mentioned that. So that being said, you know, I think your father made sure that you all had a balance. Here you are, you PKs. I mean, everybody know who PKs are. But I think the wonderful thing is that, you know, even though your dad, he worked hard. He worked hard to build a family. I can go back from the days of when he first started the church, and he did not exempt himself from his family. He included his family. And then when you got older and you graduated from high school, he was an example, you know, to his son, you know, this is how you build your family. You know, I want you to get your degree for various reasons. And even when Jay Drew wanted to go left and say, well, I may not need my degree, but
no, he said, can you hold your point?
Yeah.
He said to me, Jay Drew said, Dad, I don't need this degree. I'm just doing this for you. You remember telling me that? He said, I, you know, I make money with my music. I don't need no degree. Nobody's grown till you get a degree. Ain't you? I'm just doing this for you. And then some years later, after he got his degree, he comes back and he said, I'm glad you made me get my degree.
And you know, it goes both ways. I think if the children respect their parents and come halfway, even though sometimes they want to make their own decisions and go their way. And I think if you go, God will intervene to allow balance to come, you know, on both parties. So that's pretty much what I wanted to appreciate Daddy, because speaking of leadership, and we're getting ready to talk about that with him, we did not neglect our families. Mm-hmm. You know, we didn't neglect our families, even though you were, you know, were operating in pastoral and you're a bishop now, but you still not neglecting.
Well, you know, what some people don't know is, and I got to say this, you know, I was a bivocational pastor. And what I mean by bivocational is that I worked jobs, you know, while I was pastoring. And, you know, there was a time. And I know people, you know, they look at us now and they say, oh, you know, oh, they got it made. And then, my father and mother were excellent examples of what a family should be. You know, I mean, my mother, my father, I mean, they were just, I couldn't have asked for any better examples, you know. But what people don't know is that I was kind of stubborn, you know. I guess I'm out here now. I was kind of stubborn and I didn't want to bother my dad for a lot of stuff. And I didn't want to bother my mother-in-law for a lot of stuff. So, you know, I worked, three jobs and was going to school at one time. I was working for the Detroit Public School, the Michigan Department of Health, and Southern Christian Leadership, all at the same time, and was working on my master's. And of course, people didn't understand, you know, what I was doing. And it was sometime when our money was kind of tight, because I wouldn't go running to my father to get money, even though I could have. And I never forget one day we were sitting in the den talking, and my mother say, Mama said to me, that was stupid. You know how she would talk, that was stupid. Your daddy got money and you up here or up there struggling. Why was you struggling? You know, like that. But I wanted to make it on my own. I wanted to be able to say that we made. And so sometime I didn't have a lot of money. And so I told your mother, I said, this is what I want of you. I say, when my kids come out, I want them to look like their daddy is successful. I say, and when you come out, I want you to look like you married to a successful man. And so I didn't have but one suit, and it was a three-piece Pierre Cardin suit, J. Drew, and I wore it so much until it started shining. And I would just change my shirts, you know, but I wanted to make sure y'all was looking good. And those are the type of things that you do, that the man does to sacrifice for his family. I always made sure that your mom drove the best car. You know, I would drive the car that was tow up. Now, that's a whole nother story that we ain't got time to talk about tonight. Right. But I drove the messed up car, even though her car was the one that got wrecked. I let her drive my car and I drove her wrecked up car.
I love it. Well, speaking of, because we got notes, because we are filling a slot of Bible study, which is midweek motivation, those of Greater Emmanuel that's watching. But to just speak to the support that you all were talking about, like Jeju said, Daddy still showed up to, you know, whatever it was that we had, and he would support us financially. Unfortunately, I wasn't like you, Daddy. If I needed to ask for some money, I came right to you. God bless you. Thank you. But I would love to talk about even how you served in the kingdom with, like, I think you were doing like a relief thing for the pastors. And you went out there, even when we did, I think, something for like the inner city children, you were there giving bikes away, hugging people. And then I remember you talking about like how you don't like wearing the mask now, but of course you're doing what you need to do to stay safe and you're wearing it, but you didn't like wearing it because you like to smile at people. And to hear that from, because there, you know, some of us are like, child, I don't got to smile at nobody. You can keep this mask on my face. But I just would love to hear you talk about that, because I think that's beautiful that you never forget God's people. I've seen that firsthand.
Well, you know, it's this is and here's the thing that I've started learning how to do, and we're gonna have to master this while we're in this pandemic. You got to learn how to smile with your eyes, mm-hmm. and I'm not good at that. But I'm getting better. You got to smile, which I. But you know, people got so much, so many difficult things that they're going through. You never know what your smile will do to make somebody's day. You know, I know that. You know, when I used to be on my way to work in the morning, and you know, I'm your mama say I'm nosy, but I would look in cars, and you know, if I could catch somebody looking, I'd smile at them. You know. And you got to be able to help somebody else day get better, you know. And then if you will practice being somewhat jovial in the morning, your whole day will go better. You know, when you wake up in the morning and you are with your husband there, Kiara, don't act so grumpy. Smile. And, you know, and just smile. Me and your mom, you know, in the morning. And that's that. The whole day will go better. We wake up, ain't got nothing to say. How you ain't got nothing to say? You right there now. The old folk used to say, if you got in the car with one of the senior people and you didn't speak when you got in the car, they would say, I didn't sleep with you last night.
But you know what, honey? That's speaking of, you know, Kiara talked about, you know, how you a people person.
I don't really get that joke, unfortunately.
Okay. In other words, they say, I didn't sleep with you last night. In other words, you know, this is my first time seeing you. Speak to me.
Oh, okay.
You're so slow. You're so slow.
Did you get that, J. Drew?
You so slow.
Sorry.
Somebody say my grandmother still say that.
See there? See there? Yeah.
Wow. But you know what? Speaking of that, when Kiara was talking about the bikes, I think that touched people, even in our neighborhood, with as you as a leader. You know, you took off your tie, you took off your suit, you went out there passing out, giving out bikes, and you know, just loving the hugging babies, and you know, you were letting the people know, hey, this you have to, with loving kindness have I drawn thee. I mean, that's the scripture. And a lot of times we have to come down. People put us on a pedestal, but we are human people, and God wants us to reach down to those and reach out. And I think that as a leader and as a pastor, you're a people person. You know how to reach out. I mean, I hear some of the saints when we go to the convocation, they're like, I love Bishop Cheer because he don't even know me, but he stops and talks to me. So I think that's what it's all about, you know, reaching out to, you know, those that may not know you, but that very moment that they see you can be a moment that will change their life.
Absolutely. And I think the cool thing is we're talking about integrity in our homes and how Daddy has given himself to leaders. But I think now it kind of trickled down to the children. You too, Mommy. Both of you are always giving and willing to serve people. And I think that is commendable because there's a stereotype on preachers and pastors' wives in the church. And I would love to talk about that because I've seen Daddy give his personal funds to the local church. And he's also given not his personal funds, but have given back to the national church. So Daddy doesn't like to, you see that he just didn't even go into detail. And I was asking him to go into detail, but he doesn't like to brag about it. But in case you all are watching, and I think this still has to do with family matters. But Bishop gave, he did a relief fund. Dad, could you talk about it, please? Relief fund to the pastors. What else did you do?
Well, you know, it was, of course, this COVID-19 devastated some smaller ministries and those who were involved in ministry. And so I was giving I was helping people out of my personal funds. You know, they called me and I would help them, you know, send them money and whatnot. And it became quite overwhelming. So I decided to call on some ecumenical leaders and told them what I was going to do. I called it JDS Ministry Relief Fund. And we raised approximately $100,000, I think a total of approximately $100,000 with what I had given. And there's Gary Sprewell. He raised $100,000. Oh, he's talking about for something else. Okay. But we raised I'll come back to that, Spree. But we raised approximately $100,000. And we gave the money to all of these ministries that were affected by COVID-19that would qualify for. And all of that money went to them. And we didn't keep no handling fee, nothing. We gave it all away. And what Prophet Sprewell was talking about when Hurricane Harvey hit Houston, we sent over $100,000 there. We raised that and sent it there. And of course, truckloads of groceries and whatnot. And then, of course, when Katrina hit New Orleans, we raised over $100,000 and gave it to the pastors in New Orleans. And that's my passion. That's not anything that we're doing for accolades for man, but it's what, you know, we want to help. We want to help. I don't want to see anybody suffering. If I could, I would make sure that nobody suffered, but that's, you know, I can only do what I can, you know, and praise God that I'm able to do that and it not affect my family. I think that my wife has what she wants. My children have what they wanted. And God blessed me because I was willing to look out for other people. If the only time you do it is when people, I did an interview, Kiara, the other day, and the lady that was interviewing me, she asked me something that I never thought about. She said to me, about how many people have you assisted? And I was dumbfounded because I never thought to keep track. Right. You know, and so if you're doing this to keep track, then I question your motive. Mm-hmm. You know, I have no idea how much or how many people have been benefited from our efforts in these areas with the water crisis. When you and Kiara and Dr. Cole did a gospel concert to help the people in the Flint area, we were some of the first people on the line. And you know, you don't do stuff for people. And you know, I ain't trying to get no whatever. I just you know, I want to, you don't, you, as a matter of fact, we don't tell how many people we just slip money in their hand when they need stuff. Here, honey, go, you know, you here, honey, go. And your mama's giving people money to go get their dental work done, you know, or a hearing aid. Go get some hearing aids. You can't hear, honey. Go on, get you some hearing aids. You know, I mean, that kind of stuff. We ain't publishing that stuff. You know, we don't do it for that. And that's why God continues to bless us. And now I'm getting into a church mode. That's why God continues to make ways for you, because you don't have a problem helping other people. If all you get, look what the Bible said about the man who said, okay, I got so much stuff, I'm going to tear down my old barn and build some new barn. And the Bible said that the Lord came to him and said, you fool, tonight your soul will be required of you. Everything you get your hand on is not for you.
Yeah.
I went, okay, so I turned this into a Bible class after all. Yeah.
Which is no problem, but even to how J. Drew was talking about, like, with all of those things that you've mentioned that you don't publicize, you still have found a way to support your family, to support your children's vision. A few of my records, like JJ was saying, a few of my records were riding the wave of Bishop J. Drew Shear's pockets. God bless his heart. And then not just that, but
I want some of my money back.
Oh, that's what come with the game. Charge it. But even the Clark sisters, one last time. And then I think, again, going back to when we were talking about learning just through J. Drew, that there, and you said it before in a few of your Bible studies, where you said the gospel is bigger, your purpose is bigger than you, it goes beyond you. And you, people don't talk about it, but you were an executive producer. I don't know, well, I know there's maybe one other bishop that has some kind of influence or work in the entertainment industry, but you are an executive producer. They don't know that for the Clark Sisters movie. And I think that is just amazing. You just don't talk about this stuff, but you don't forget, I don't know, I had this lighter, but you don't forget about your family. And I think that is what's fun. J. Drew had a celebrity friend come to the church and somebody said something off the wall, and you corrected it immediately. It's just, you're a family man all the way around, not just with your squad, but just with everybody. And so that's just so commendable. Our time is up, but I do want to ask these hot potato questions. Jaju, do you have a most memorable and funny story? Uh-oh, you can't show that one. A most memorable and funny story about your parents or your sister?
Oh yeah, the one that's, this actually just happened like last year. Well, we only a month in, but we went to a high-end restaurant, and it was us four, and we was laughing at something, and for some reason we could not stop laughing, and it was very quiet, and it was just a very high-end five-star restaurant, you know. So we were obviously just I think we was the only blacks at the time, so we just sitting there minding our business, and we saw something, we just laughing. We kind of loud, but we trying to be quiet. So Bishop, we trying to, all of us, me, Mama, and Kiki, we just being quiet just because Daddy here. If Daddy wasn't here, we probably would have been screaming. We was trying to be quiet. We ended up laughing. We just laughing hard. And I'm trying to like hold in my laugh, and I couldn't hold it in, and I threw up all over the table. Because we was laughing so hard. And that was just the most embarrassing and the most memorable moment with y'all. And I still remember that.
He was trying to hold it because he knew Daddy was going to be upset in this five-star restaurant. If we act a fool, we cut up, he's going to be mad at us. Say, that's not how I raised y'all. So he held it in, but he couldn't hold it in no longer. Bless his heart.
I remember that. But I also remember taking y'all to this other restaurant. We there having fun, real sophisticated. And then you and Kiki start to acting like y'all ain't had no training, just started doing stuff with your hands. I say, oh, stop. And I was going crazy like that.
Oh, you didn't like for us to sop that bread. We'll create soup, like soup as gravy. I mean, you talk about Black folks. We knew how to eat it. We took the culture with us. We didn't care about, and Daddy was trying to show class and dignity and be conservative. Me and J. Drew was acting like we was from Crooklyn. It was no problem. We the shears, but we came from Crooklyn. But the fun thing was we would take that bread, sop that in that soup. So then I tried to be, you know, a little classy, and I tried to cut it one time and fork it and then put it in the soup. He was like, don't do it at all. But that is hilarious. I have a story too. One story was, this is when I was losing my head. And Daddy, what would you say? How old was I when you kept thinking I was just going out on the back end?
Out on the what, honey?
Back end.
You talking about when...
When you chopped my shoulder.
Yeah, you was about 14, I guess, 14, 15, something like that.
Okay. Well, this story is, my dad's lesson was always don't hit Kiara on her face. Don't hit her on her legs. Just hit her on her behind, because I don't want her to, I want her to have pretty legs and I want her to keep a pretty face. But she was going to get a whooping. So Daddy, this time though, I think I was a little older, like 18, because this is when I was driving. And I think so, because this was around time when you and Nana had a fit that I dyed my hair blonde down the middle. Oh. Do you remember I did that?
Yes.
So this is just when I was going out on the back end. Daddy didn't know whether he wanted to hit me, punch me. So he just moved me back and forth and just started chopping my shoulder. It was karate chops. I'm like, how is the bishop karate chopping me on my shoulders? So, you know, if you laugh while your parent is correcting you, you're going to get in more trouble. But I wanted to laugh hysterically. But that was a story for me.
No, I will. Let me give a little narration here. Okay. What happened is that Kiara, she was kind of smelling herself, as the old people say. And so Kiara, I said something to Kiara, and Kiara looked back at me like, and I said, oh, no, you won't. And the Holy Ghost anointed me to get me out of that chair. And then I started chopping you. You know, there is a parental anointing.
Is there?
They Drew is learning that now.
I love it. Ma, did you have a story?
I think I remember one when J. Drew, I remember when J. Drew was younger and we was at the Southfield Church, and J. Drew played a trick on me, and I'm in church, you know, and I'm praying, I'm praising the Lord, and I'm saying, hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. And so, and I'm just, I mean, I was crying, I mean, hands up in the middle of my worship. And J. Drew standing on the bench, and he taps me and says, mommy, look at my eyes. It's something wrong with them. And he was looking cross-eyed. And I said, the blood of Jesus. Oh, God, touch my eye, my baby's eyes in the name of Jesus. The blood of Jesus. There's something wrong with my child. Something wrong. And then I look up, and he said, mommy, I'm okay. I'm okay. I'm okay. So he just played tricks, and that was just the enemy using him to break away from my moment of praise.
Oh,
you know, can I talk about how often J. Drew played tricks on you, and it was hilarious? The stories about when we were in the store. So we would be in the stores, and mommy would panic and say, where's J. Drew? Kiki, find J. Drew. Meanwhile, you know, me and J. Drew, it's not that much of a difference in our age, but she couldn't find J. Drew. J. Drew would be in the display with the mannequins under the dress. Or posing, and he would have everybody, like the clerk, please page my son. So we'd be like, paging J. Drew Shear, paging J. Drew Shear, your mother's looking for you. And I'd be like, mommy, he right here.
So
having a panic attack, ready to send out an Amber Alert.
So embarrassing, but look at him now. So hey, parents, don't give up on your children. God will cover them and allow them to fall in the ways of the way we pray for them. So God bless you, J. Drew.
Daddy, do you have a story?
Well, I'm going to give you a story, and we can end because this is not a laughing matter. I'm going to give you a story. I recall when we lived on Otter Drive, and for some reason, we couldn't find J. Drew. You remember that? And it was a scary moment. Mm-hmm. And I went all through the alleys, and oh, my heart was just, yeah, just beating like crazy. We couldn't find him. And I was scared. You know, I was scared. I walked through the alleys all around, and I don't even know what happened, but we finally found him. But my point is that, you know, when you love your family, when you love your children, and there's a possibility of some harm coming to them, you know, everything just, nothing means anything anymore other than your relationship with God and his ability to give you the grace to find what you think you've lost. And that's what happened. And I'll never forget that, because I was losing my mind because I didn't know where he was. He couldn't have been, oh my God, couldn't have been no more than about 5 or 6, and something like that.
That was during the time that somebody was out snatching children.
Yeah, during the time that they were snatching kids and stuff, you know. Mm-hmm. So it was a horrible moment. But nevertheless, we found him. I don't know where we found him. Probably, look at I don't know where we found him. He probably was somewhere. I don't think he wasn't playing a trick that time. He was just somewhere playing. But we were just, and I don't know why he couldn't. He must have been in somebody's house.
Yeah,
because we were hollering, J. Drew, and just couldn't find him. It was a scary moment. I'll never forget it. But so that, you know, when your family is close like that, you have those moments where everything is over and nothing is important. If something, you know, just like when your mom got sick, nothing was important other than us seeing about her, you know. And so God has been good to our family, you know. And so here we are, and we praise God for the victories that we have.
Right. And I think it's important in this day and time because, you know, so many families have separated. So many families have, you know, caused things to build up in their heart against one another. And I think this is so important, especially in our churches, is that we pass it down, you know, even to in the church, out of the church, to let people know that God, that's the way he built families to feed off of each other and feed off of one another and pass it down to generation after generation. So important.
Yeah.
So we're losing our family. So
yeah.
Thank you for this night with my family.
Okay. Anything else, J. Drew?
No. Good. I had a wonderful time with my family, and I thank you all for the invite.
But J. Drew, before we go, can we just ask you, what are some of the tips? You've been a great father, and some of the tips that you have learned from your father that you have perhaps experience, and some of his tips help you to father your children.
Yeah, absolutely. Everything I know about fatherhood was came solely from example. And, you know, now that I'm able to see now, I mean, most importantly, the thing that I did have is having the support. So, of course, you know, that taught me to be able to support my children as much as I can, and to, you know, just lead by example as well. I know a lot of times, you know, we wasn't talkers, but my dad showed us by just living the life, you know, which was a great example for me, because now that's the same thing I call myself doing with Jay, with my son now. So it's like, you know, I tell, and when I used to get in trouble, like, And my dad used to be, you know, he'd say, what you doing? Where you get that from? You ever seen me do that? Do we talk like that? Do I talk? You know, so, you know, that just leading by example. So that's what I try to do as much as I can with, you know, my kids. And I know that Jay is watching me, and, you know, so it's been great. And, you know, I'm just so grateful to have what I have, because it just make me appreciate it even more when I see, you know, the same symptoms that I am experiencing with my kids as well, and being able to set example for them. So, yeah.
And then I've also heard, and I'm going to leave it alone after this. I've also heard you say, and I was glad to hear it, that, you know, of course, J. Drew isn't married now. He's a single man. And I've heard him say in our talks, I want my wife to be like my mom. And I thought that was so, you know, I thought that was so wonderful to hear.
Amen. So,
anything, let me say to the
Whoever she is, she got some big shoes to fill.
Let me say to the listening and viewing audience that everything that J. Drew does is wonderful to evangelist Karen Clark Shear. Can I get a witness?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So,
but yeah. Me and Mama, we here too. But I mean, I guess like you said, I'm Drew's girl and he's Karen's boy. So
it's all love good. You both. Yeah, we love you both. All right, now maybe we'll have to do this again because we didn't get to even 60% of our questions, did we?
No.
You know, it's a lot of people asking questions too. I heard a lot of people. So maybe next time we'll have a moment of, you know, taking their questions and getting them in early.
Yeah, maybe so.
We're quarantined. We don't have anywhere to go.
Right. Well, but I don't like to hold people. You know, they may have something to do. They may have something to do tonight and I don't want to hold them. Well, I was trying to stay within my Bible class. I wanted to my Bible class time. And so that's what I wanted to do. I'm going to ask you, they say, yes, do it again. OK, we will. But this is on a Wednesday night Bible class. And so I'm going to ask you, if you will, to please sow a seed into the Greater Emmanuel Ministry. If you can, it's the Cash App, and all of the modes of giving are at the bottom of the screen. They're scrolling. And if you'll be so kind to sow a seed into our ministry, this is all a part of ministry. If you're to sow into Greater Emmanuel, this the ministry of giving. You can go to Cash App, $GEIKojic1. You can go to PayPal at paypal@geikojic.org. You can text to give at GEI offer and put in space and then your dollar amount. I'm sorry, you text to give by texting to 28950 and then you put in GEI offer a space and the dollar amount. Or you can always mail it in to GEI at 19190 Schaefer. That's Bishop J. Drew Shear Boulevard, Detroit, Michigan, 48235, or you can be sure to search on Giblify, and then you will be able to give. Search and make sure you see our logo. Listen, let me tell you something. Tomorrow, of course, you know, I'll be in prayer. I have a tremendous line up for our prayer tomorrow. It's going to be a blessing. I hope that you will join us. Many of you have been joining us on a weekly basis, and I know that you have been blessed by the prayer. But on tomorrow, my guests will include, of course, my darling wife will be praying with me. And then, of course, Evangelist Vicky Brooks, one of our own there at Greater Emmanuel, that prayer warrior, Pastor Mark Vereen, my big sis all the way from California, Pastor Maria Gardner Langston will be with us. And then my sister, Dr. Dorinda Clark Cole, and my brother from Baltimore, Maryland, Bishop William McMillan. And of course, our dear sister from Monroe, Louisiana, Prophetess Janet Floyd. You don't want to miss that tomorrow. It is our 46th week of prayer, our 46th week of prayer. And we'll be praying tomorrow at 12 noon. Join us because the Lord meets us in a special way. And you don't want to miss this event. Kiara, you wanted to make an announcement about something?
Sure. I was going to mention that we're doing a Valentine's Day thing with Jordan and I, Jordan, with our parents. And I don't know if I'm freezing.
Yes, yeah. You are.
I guess we can show it, Tasia. I'm freezing.
We see it.
We see it. The OG, okay, cool, versus the young buck.
But it's happening on February.
For some reason, you're freezing. Okay. I don't know. She'll come back in and maybe y'all can hear me.
You can just take it, Daddy.
No, there you go. Go ahead. Go ahead, Kiara. I don't know. Okay. It's a virtual Valentine's Day event. It's going to be the OGs, I guess that's me and you, Sister Sheard, the OGs versus the young bloods. So the young bucks. So that's Jordan and Kiara. And so that's going to be fine. That's going to be super fun. And it's just $25. Join us on Valentine's Day. You can't go to the restaurant. So join us and let's do it. All right. All right. Okay, I think that we covered everything. Is there anything else? Join us on something is happening tomorrow night. Yes, tomorrow night we have this service where our own mother, Corrine Wade Adams, you can check it out. We'll be posting it because I don't have all this stuff at my fingertip, but you can check it out and join us tomorrow at 7 o'clock for a service. All right, we got a little guest came in.
Say hi.
Who, yeah, okay. All right. God bless.
Thank you for joining us, everyone. I hope this was a blessing to you. And hey, Jacob.
Oh, there's Jacob. Hey, man.
Grandchildren joining us.
Yeah.
And we hope that from our family to yours, that you be blessed. And we're praying blessings, generational blessings over your family. So we'll do it again. How many of you want it again? Put the fire in the chat if you want it again. Oh. I see it. I see the fire's coming up. Yes. Yeah. God bless all of you. Thank you again. And
please remember to sow those seeds into this so I don't get in trouble there at Greater Emmanuel. Please give. We're on Greater Emmanuel's broadcast. However, I am the pastor, but nevertheless, we want to make sure that we're doing right by the ministry. And dear Lord, we thank you once again for how you blessed us. Bless these seeds that will be sown into this fertile ground and cause them to multiply, not only for the sake of ministry, but for the sake of our personal lives in Jesus' name. And now, Lord, dismiss us from this place, this setting, but never from your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen. God bless everybody. What a joy. I don't know what happened to Kiara. All right, Jacob, what you got? Let me see that shirt you got on. What did it say?
Gamers chill, I think.
What?
I don't know what it really says.
Gamers gonna
chill.
Chill. All right, sir.
All right.
Okay, see y'all later.
See y'all.
All right.